A lot of people as believers think that Christians are victims. We're not victims in any way, shape, or form. That's not what the Word teaches us. And one of the first things we have to learn to do to walk victoriously in the Lord is to get rid of the victim mentality. And that's something that is sometimes a difficult journey for people. Because quite honestly, we're raised in a culture, we're raised in a society that quite honestly teaches a lot of us that we are victims. And makes it think like we're the victim of our circumstances, we're the victims of our situations, we're the victim of this, we're the victim of that. And society will teach us to play that game well. That society owes me this because I'm a victim. People owe me this because I'm a victim. And you can fill in the blank, a victim of what? But there's a lot of voices out there trying to teach us that we are victims. The Word of God is absolutely 100% contrary to that. And I think as we look at Ephesians chapter 2, we're going to look at verse 6 this morning. And I kind of have hinted at it and touched upon it a little bit in the last couple weeks. This, I believe, is ultimately where the prayer in Ephesians chapter 1, beginning at verse 15, leads to. I think it leads ultimately to Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 6. And that tells us that we're not a victim. Amen? You cannot believe Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6, and believe you're a victim. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 6. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now, we cannot be raised up with Christ Jesus in heavenly places and be a victim. It's impossible. Let me begin with the prayer in verse 15, and I'm going to read through that up to verse 6, because I think we have to do that to really grasp the meaning of what's taking place here. Wherefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. The eyes of your understanding be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glorious of inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead, and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principalities and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. And you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ, by grace you are saved. Verse 6, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And I've shared with this in the last couple of weeks. We see it in the prayer there that Paul is praying for the church in Ephesus, that they will receive revelation of something. And one of the things that he's praying they would receive revelation of is that Christ is on the right hand of the Father, a place of all power and authority. Now, but if you also notice there, I think many believers say, well, I don't really struggle with that. I understand that. I can, you know, close my eyes. I can picture Jesus sitting on the right hand of the Father. But then we continue on, and then we say, but do you see yourself in a place of authority? And do you see yourself as sitting together with him in a place of authority? And that changes everything and how we look at things considerably. Because the reason I say most seem to go through life talking like a victim. Seem to go through life acting to a good degree of it like a victim, rather than like a victor. Acting like the conquered rather than a conqueror. Acting like somebody who just get beat up and kicked around by life, rather than somebody that's sitting in a place of victory. But according to the Word of God, as a believer, we operate and we function from a place of victory. We operate and function from a place of authority. We operate and function on the right hand of the Father, so to speak, in a place of victory. Now, that's good news, but it also implies certain responsibility. That means we can't act like a victim no more and say, oh, poor me, I'm doing the best I can, but this is just what the devil just ate me alive. Throw the pity out the window. Hallelujah. Everybody says, well, I don't know about all that. I kind of like having my pity. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6 says, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Raised us up together. Together. And made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. There's a big word there that we need to stop and consider this morning, and that's the word together. Raise us up together. Together. We see that word there twice. The word together is there twice. Now, it's interesting to understand something. In the Greek language, is a very precise language. I'm certainly not somebody who's done a lot of study of all these things, but people who have say it's the most precise language we've ever had. And that's the reason that at that point in time, God did this, because the language was ripe and ready to be communicated. But a lot of times we'll read, you know, the Greek words in English, and that's actually two different words. That's two different words there that are translated both together. Now, there's not huge differences in them, but yet they are a little bit more precise. An example I always use is the word love. You know, we say that, well, I love banana splits, and I love God. Well, that's kind of silly to put both in the same category, isn't it? But in the English language, we've only got one love. If I love banana splits and I love God, I don't have any choice, and I have to use the same word. Now, we understand in Greek there's several words for love that's more precise. But here these two together that are translated together in English are actually two different Greek words. So there is a fine distinction there, but they really do mean almost the same thing. But if you notice there, that word together, and hath raised us up together, means simply to rouse from death in company with. To rouse from death in company with. The second together is a little bit different, though. It is like you're going into a big banquet hall, and this banquet hall is there to celebrate some great dignitary. You know, the president's there or something. And you walk into that big banquet hall, and there's Donald Trump across the room whispering, hey, you, come here, sit down right by me. In other words, come have a seat and sit together with me at my table. So we see here that it's talking about, as a believer, we were raised up in company with Christ Jesus. And when we were raised up, Jesus said, hey, you come over here and have a seat at my table. You have a seat at this table of honor. You have a seat at this place of authority. You see, what we've got to understand, beloved, is when Christ went upon the cross, He went upon the cross, he died, he was buried, he was resurrected, he ascended to the right hand of the Father, and we were invited through the trail. We were invited to go with him. We were invited to die his death. We were invited to be buried in that grave. We were invited to the resurrection, and we were invited to the ascension to be on the right hand of the Father. And through the eyes of faith, God seen down through the ages, and he sees that maybe you and I did not physically go upon the cross. You and I maybe physically didn't die the death. You and I maybe physically weren't put into the grave. You and I physically maybe weren't resurrected at that time. You and I physically maybe were not lifted up to be on the right hand of the Father. But in the eyes of faith, God sees that we be like, oh, I'm going to show it to you all day long. Fasten your seatbelts if you think, I don't know about that, I'd rather be the victim. I'd rather just be able to go around telling everybody what the devil's doing to me. Stop it. What did I tell you when you tell him to stop? He can't do that without your permission. Hallelujah. We've been walking with this so far. You see, we're seated with him. He invited us to come and sit down with him. Now, go back to Ephesians chapter 1, and we're just going to very quietly, calmly go through this today, because we're seeking what the church in Ephesus had, that you'll walk out of here today and say, I'll never be a victim again. I'll never be a victim again. I'll never be, the devil will never bully me again. You know, I knew this guy, I don't know why this guy can come to mind. This sounds like one of my crude illustrations, but I don't know how else to share it. It's kind of graphic, but there was a gentleman that I knew, and I met him in Florida when I lived down there. And he's kind of a rough character. And a drug dealer, actually. But, and he grew up in a very rough background. And he had been an adopted child and greatly abused. I mean, physically beaten, physically abused throughout his childhood. And he used to always talk about the day that stopped. And one day, the individual in the home that was always beating him called up and hit him across the jaw and broke his jaw. And he said he just felt that jaw snap. And said he just snapped. He just went nuts and just attacked his abuser. And just popping the snot out of him. And said he made a decision that day that nobody would ever beat him again. And you see, that's a kind of a crude example. But most of us have probably known examples like that. Where somebody maybe was bullied and bullied and bullied and beaten and beaten and beaten and abused throughout their life. And one day they snapped and they said, never again. It's never going to happen again. And see, that's what I'm kind of after today, that spiritually something will happen. A light bulb will go off on the inside of you and you'll say, Satan, never again. You'll never be my bully again in my life. I'll never allow that again. Because I've got some understanding of who I am in Christ Jesus. I've got some understanding of the authority that's upon my life. I've got some understanding of the weaponry I have. And if you want to come challenge me and you want to come mess with me, I'll guarantee you I'm going to pull out the name of Jesus. I'll guarantee you I'm going to pull out the Word of God. I guarantee you you're going to come somebody who's dressed in the full armor of God. Never again, Satan. Never again. Ephesians chapter 1. Verse 20 and 21. So he set us together with him, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. Now this place on his own right hand, verse 21 tells us clearly what that place is. Far above all principality and power, and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. So it is a place of authority, isn't it? That place that he's saying we sit together with him is a place above all principalities, above all power, above all might, above all dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. So we understand we're seated together with Christ, and we're seated together with Christ in a place of authority over all the powers of the enemy. You with me so far? You see, one of the things we've got to understand as a church, we are not a victim. We have power, and we have authority. We have power, and we have authority. We have power, and we have authority. And where I think the church has greatly been hindered and wounded in this area is there's been a divide in the body of Christ, and we don't understand we have power and authority. Let me give you one example of what I'm talking about. I grew up spiritually. My background was primarily in the classic old line Pentecostal movement. That's kind of where I was kind of reared at. And I was exposed to a lot of people then who taught a lot about faith. Now, I noticed something really early on in my walk with the Lord as I began to kind of hobnob with these two groups of people. And one is, I noticed something, they're both right. But they were both lacking in some area. You know, you have the old school Pentecostal background that I grew up with. They understood, they preached about the power of the Holy Ghost. But they didn't understand any revelation about authority. And then I started met these people who were teaching a lot about faith and emphasizing that. They understood their authority. But they didn't seem to grasp very well about power. And so there we had a divided group, and some were after the power, and the others were after authority, and they didn't quite come together properly. But you see, beloved, to do what we desire to do as a church, it's required that we have power and authority. It's required that we walk in the full power of the Holy Spirit, but it's also required that we have a full, complete revelation of the authority that we have in Christ Jesus. Go to Luke chapter 9, I'll show you. I didn't make that up. This is one of these things one day, that really used to trouble me. One day I remember I was reading through Luke's scriptures, and I came across this verse, and it just exploded inside of me when I seen that. I thought, Lord, that's it. That's where we're lacking. We've got to understand the power. We've got to understand our authority. Luke chapter 9, verse 1 and 2. Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority. He gave them both. Over all devils, and to cure diseases. Now, does that sound like he sent them out as victims? You go down there, and the devil's going to eat you alive. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. So he gave them power and authority, correct? Power and authority. Power and authority. He did the same thing with the church. He did the same thing with the 70. He told us in Acts chapter 8, you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. He gave us authority in the name of Jesus. He's telling us here that we're seated on the right hand of the Father in heavenly places, a place of authority. You see, beloved, the church is called to be a people of power. The church is called to be a people of authority. And we're sitting around letting the devil bully us and rob us and steal from us like we're his victims. We were sent forth to exercise the victory that Christ has already won. We were sent forth to trample him underfoot and do the works of the kingdom of God, not to be his victim. Hallelujah. Power! Yeah, I'm so excited. I'm all out here. Power! I like that word. I get excited when I say power! And it's over. So, he sent the church forth into going to all the world with power and authority. But something happened over the years. We allowed the devil to enter in and rob the church of its power. We've allowed the devil to enter in and to rob our understanding of authority to where we're living like helpless people being bullied by the enemy. Beloved, we are sent forth. The book of Ephesians, we're going to see this more and more. Ephesians chapter 5 talks about the walking in the fullness of the power of the Holy Spirit. Ephesians chapter 6 talks about the whole armor of God and our battles against the enemy and all of his little bit that's been defeated. You see, he's trying to get them to understand who they are, trying to get them to understand who the church is, and to rise up and to go forth in what God had called them to do and the power and the authority that already had been given to them. Hallelujah. And we go forth and we proclaim the gospel in power. We go forth in authority, and as we proclaim the gospel, there are those who hear, there are those who are believed, and the Bible tells us they are called out to be called by his name in Acts chapter 15, verse 14, and they join the army, and they got power, and they got authority, and we go forth in power, and we go forth in authority. Amen. You have that picture yet? to Ephesians chapter 1 for just a moment. And we're just going to ponder on this morning a little bit. Because this is something we need to change the way we think in some areas. Ephesians chapter 1, let's look at this prayer again. We'll start this time in verse 16. Cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe according to the working of his mighty power. What's he praying for that church to receive? He's praying for them to receive revelation and understanding. He's not praying for them to receive anything they don't already have. The whole prayer is based upon them to get revelation, to get understanding of what they have. They're not praying that God give them anything. He's just praying that they would get revelation and understanding of what they have. Of what they have. Of what they have. And sometimes, beloved, people don't understand what they have. And if they don't understand what they have, sometimes they will operate and function in fear. Let me give you a couple of sports stories. It's a funny thing. I don't know if any of you ever played baseball, but there's a certain element of fear of a baseball. There just is. I mean, you go stand up at my home plate and have somebody throw a baseball at you 100 miles an hour. And tell me that little sense of fear don't rise up in you a little bit. I mean, even baseball players go through that. Usually, first of the year, you're kind of getting over that. I was always an infielder, and there was that first practice or two. There was that element of that first ball bounces at your face, you know. That element of overcoming that element of fear. Some people have a really hard time overcoming that fear. And I remember coaching, especially kids, when I would coach them. There was one kid in particular, he was a really good baseball player. And he was really talented. I mean, athletically a very talented kid. But he was terrified of the baseball. He just had a terrible fear of the baseball. And I had the hardest time. He'd get up there. I mean, he was a really good hitter, but he would just tighten up when he'd get to the plate because he was afraid the ball was going to hit him. So I had a great coaching idea. I knew how to get him over that. I threw the baseball at him. And it worked. You know why? Because he didn't know what he had. He didn't know he really had the ability to get out of the way of the pitch. You know, 99 times out of 1,000, when the pitch is coming at you, you've got the ability to get out of the way. The only time you really get hit is for some reason that pitch just totally fools you and just comes from somewhere you don't expect it. But you're quick enough, you're agile enough to get out of the way of that baseball. And once he realized that, he was fine. But until he realized what he had fear. And I see that in the body of Christ with believers. There's believers who have fear of the devil. There's believers who have fear of demons. Why would you fear demons? See everybody's foot and everybody's faces. You have authority over him. Why would you fear him? You know, I always tell the story, but it always comes to mind. I remember my kids were really little, they were going to some house, and Dad, what if it's haunted? And I says, it won't be when I get in there, because I'll tell them to leave. Why would a Christian fear the devil? Why would a Christian fear demons? Why would a Christian fear... There's all kinds of believers who don't want to deal with that. They'll call you, you come and pray with this person, I think there's a demon. Oh, no, 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 I'm terrified. You deal with it. Why? Because they don't know what they have. If they understand, understood their authority, they wouldn't, there's little demons in a wicked body. They understood who they were in Christ spiritually, on the right hand of the Father, in a place of authority, there would be no fear of the enemy. With me so far? So that's what he's praying for, is revelation to take place. That church will understand who and what they are in Christ. You see, that's what we've got to understand, why it's so important to understand this, where the battle is. The Bible talks about Satan, how he blinds the eyes and blinds the minds of people. And we know that count in Daniel chapter 10, where Daniel was praying for some revelation, and you know, he went on a 20-day, what they call a Daniel fast, or the Bible doesn't call it a fast. 21 days he changed his diet. And he changed his diet, and then he prayed for that period of time, and then finally Michael had his little battle in the heavenlies and broke through and got the word to Daniel that, you know, that he had heard it the first time he prayed, and all of this stuff. But we understood, where was the battle at there? The battle was the revelation. The battle was the understanding coming through. In other words, heaven had heard the prayer, but the revelation was taking place in the battle for the revelation was taking place in the heavenlies. And what I'm sharing with you today, and what I'm teaching you today, is one of the number one areas that there is a battle in the heavenlies about, because the last thing the enemy wants you to realize is that you've got authority over him, as long as he's got you bound up with fear and you don't have understanding of who you are in Christ, as long as he's got the church all bound up with fear and they don't have understanding of who they are in Christ, then they're not going to exercise that authority. So this is an area of tremendous battling. There used to be a time in my life, and I'm rambling, I know, but just, there used to be a time in my life when I would preach on topics like this, then stupid stuff would happen. I said, oh yeah, the devil knew what I was going to preach. But no. I'm not going to allow him to do that. Why would I allow him to bully me because of what I'm going to preach? That was an element of fear. You met me so far? You got sure to look thoughtful this morning. Praise God.
Thank you, Pastor.
Praise the Lord. Ephesians chapter 5. Thoughtful looking, will be. You see, all of this that I'm sharing with you all comes out of the book of Ephesians. And as we tie it all together, you begin to see. You see, the book of Ephesians, one of the key things is glorious church. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Now, when we're talking about the glorious church, there's three key things that we find in the book of Ephesians that really, along this line, one is revelation of their authority. One is Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18, you're going to find talking about living a spirit-filled life, living in the fullness of the Holy Spirit. Ephesians chapter 6, you're going to find out about the whole armor of God. So we see these three key elements. The glorious church has to be a church who has an understanding of the authority they have in Christ Jesus. The glorious church has to be a church who's walking in the full power of the Holy Spirit. A glorious church has to be a church who's wearing the whole armor of God. And that's what the book of Ephesians is about here. That's what God is doing through the Apostle Paul, is trying to get the church in Ephesus and to give us a model of this and to show us what the glorious church is and how it is supposed to walk. And one of the key elements is revelation of our authority. Amen?
Amen.
You with me so far?
Yes.
You sure? You see, one of the things we've got to understand, and we do understand, like I said, there's power and there's authority. And one of the things I've got to mention, you do understand there's a difference between the two. There's a difference between power and there's a difference between authority. You can have power and not authority. You can have authority and no power. Right? I mean, just if I had a set of weights here and they weighed 500 pounds, and I said, I authorize all of you to come up and lift them. You'd have full authority to play with my weights. You'd have full authority to use my weights. So come up and lift those 500 pounds. Probably nobody here would have the power to do that. Possibly Aaron. I mean, I'm sure he'd come up with Jane. But you'd be fully authorized to do it. But you wouldn't have power to lift 500 pounds. Right? Now, I can take a 100-pound weight and I can put it out on my front porch, and maybe many of you would have the power to lift 100 pounds, but you don't have the authority to come on my front porch and play with my weights unless I invite you to. So you can have authority and not power. You can have power but not authority. You can have power to kick in a front door but not have authority to do it. The two are completely different. But the Bible tells us that the church has been given power to accomplish it and authority to do it. With me so far? Okay, now here's where we're going to get down to the nitty-gritty of really grasping this. Now we understand that Jesus went and died on a cross. Jesus was buried. Who did he do that for? Who did Jesus die for? He died for us, didn't he? Jesus died for us. When Jesus came to this earth and died on the cross, he did that for no other reason, right, other than us. Right? I mean, he didn't need that for himself, did he? Did Jesus need to come to the earth and die? He didn't need to, did he? But when Jesus was buried, why was he buried? Who did he do that for? He did that for us, didn't he? That was our death. When Jesus was resurrected, who did he do that for? That was for us, wasn't it, to be justified? So we know that when Jesus came to the earth, Jesus died for us. Jesus was buried for us. Jesus was resurrected for us. So then, who was Jesus ascended to the right hand of the Father for? Does that all of a sudden change? If he came to die for us, if he came to be buried for us, if he resurrected for us, then wasn't his return to the place of authority for us? You see, I got a newsflash for you. Jesus didn't need to come to the earth. He didn't need to die. He didn't need to be buried. He didn't need to be resurrected to obtain a power and authority. He already had it, didn't he? I mean, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. He created all things. Nothing was created within him. In him was life. He already had all power and all authority. He had the power and authority to create all things. He had the power and authority of eternal life. He already had all of it. So obviously he didn't need to leave heaven, come down here, die on the cross, be buried, resurrected, ascended on the right hand of the Father to obtain anything for himself. Correct? So he died on the cross, he was buried, he was resurrected, ascended on the right hand of the Father to obtain eternal life and to obtain authority for us. Right? You with me so far? Luke chapter 10, verse 19. I'm trying to be systematic about this. It's hard to do. Luke chapter 10, verse 19. Everything Jesus came to this earth to do was for us. For our redemption, for our salvation, for restoration of what was lost in the fall. Right? Luke chapter 10, verse 19. What does it say? Behold, I give unto you power. That is authority. The King James translates that power. Everywhere else, that word is translated authority. Behold, I give unto you authority. Probably the New King James says authority, don't it?
Yeah.
And the King James says power. New King James says authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. He came, he died, he was buried, he was resurrected, he was ascended on the right hand of the Father to give us authority to do what? To go ahead and just stomp all over him. Is that not what it says in the Bible? Is there anything in that verse that remotely indicates to you that behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions over all the power of the enemy. Is there any power of the enemy that we have reason to fear? We have authority over all the power of the enemy, correct? Doesn't the Bible say resist the devil and he will do what? He will flee from you. I got a homework assignment. Look up that word flee in the Greek and see what it says. That means turn and run as hard and as fast as you can and get out of town as quick as you can in fear and terror. Resist the devil and he will run. He will get out of town. He will flee from you in fear. Not because of who you are, but because of the authority that's been given to you to use the name of Jesus, the name above all names. You with me? I sometimes when you're studying and you're meditating on the scriptures throughout the week and preparing to teach, you'll hear different things throughout the week that just really jumps out at you because of what's on your mind. And I don't mean this to be offensive to anybody in any way, shape, or form. I'm going to use this illustration as a teaching point of how people think. And I was listening, I've just been going over these scriptures, and I was listening to a radio, I was going to the radio, just playing and just listening to different things. I don't know if to listen much of anything, but I'll go through stations. And I came to this one station that happened to be a Catholic radio station. And they're interviewing this Catholic individual, this priest or whatever he was, I'm not sure. And it was a call-in show where you call and you've got your problems, and you tell them, and then they give you their pastoral advice. And this lady called, her life was just a terrible mess. And the person's response was, just call upon Mary and ask her to get you out of the mess. Now, excuse me. Excuse me. We have authority over the power of the enemy in the name of Jesus. Amen. Why would you call on Mary? I can't find anywhere in that word where it gave Mary any kind of authority other than what I have. I have authority over all the power of the enemy in the name of Jesus. Why would I think like a victim down here got to call out to somebody of human's name and try to come and get me out of some mess? You know, and you hear me talk about this all the time, que sera, sera theology, you know, whatever it is to be, will be. And a lot of the churches taught people, well, you know, it's just God's will, you just got to learn how to endure it. Then why did he give me authority over all the power of the enemy? If all I can do is endure what the enemy's doing to me, why did he give me authority over him? Did he not plan on us using it? Did he not plan on the church rising up and putting on the whole armor of God and speaking the word of God and proclaiming the name of Jesus and walking in authority and power? Then why did he give it? Why did Jesus die? Why was he buried? Why was he resurrected? Why did he ascend to be on the right hand of the Father to purchase and restore authority to us so we could go out there and just take a beating? It doesn't make sense. It doesn't line up with the word of God, beloved. And the body of Christ needs to get revelation and rise up and realize who they are in Christ Jesus. We are not victims. Amen. We are not the enemy's victim. We are not this world's victim. Greater is he who is in us than he that is in the world. We go forth in power. We go forth in authority. We go forth in the whole armor of God. We go forth with the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of the living God. That doesn't sound like a victim. We are more than conquerors in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
But we've got to get this victim mentality out of our minds. Hallelujah. Every time I say that, I get these off. Rise up in the authority that Christ has purchased for you. Say, why? Go to Acts chapter 3. We got all this power. We got all this authority. Why we ain't seeing more happen? Acts chapter 3. How about that? Acts chapter 3. Hallelujah. Peter and John went to the temple at the hour of prayer. And there was a man there that had been lame from his mother's womb, begging alms. What did Peter say to him? Silver and gold have I none. Like I said, body of Christ always liked that part. They've got the rest of it. But what I have, I give unto thee. Rise up and walk in the name of Jesus. Now the part that I like about that is gives the other part that people always leave out. Is, oh, he jumped right around. No, he didn't. Peter walked over, grabbed him by the hands, and put him on his feet because he didn't jump up when he told him to rise up. You see, Peter understood what he had. He understood that he had authority in the name of Jesus. He seen that lame man. Spirit of God rose up inside him. Rise up and walk in the name of Jesus. That's how the church is supposed to operate. That's what Paul is praying for the church in Ephesus to get revelation of. The authority they have. But you see, beloved, here's where we come back to the same old again. We have to really have revelation of it. It can't be, well, maybe you might hope so. It has to be something that the Spirit of God has taken His Word and brought forth revelation on the inside of our spirit. So when we say, rise up and walk in the name of Jesus, it's with full authority. Authority is a funny thing. Oh, you read Acts chapter 3, verse 16. And His name, this is Peter explaining to him what just happened. And His name, through faith in His name. That's why there's got to be revelation. Can't be religion. It's got to be revelation. Through faith in His name, have made this man strong, whom you see and know. Yea, the faith which is by Him hath given him his perfect soundness in the presence of you. For the church of Ephesus to have revelation so they will rise up in faith in the authority that they have in the name of Jesus Christ and not be a victim. Tell him to quit. Is what I say to you guys all the time. That's very sound theology. You have authority. The Bible says, don't give place to the devil. If I didn't have authority over him, how could I be told not to give place to him? It sounds to me like it's up to me whether or not he gets place or not, doesn't it? I mean, if it's up to him and I'm just a victim, don't tell me not to give place to him. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 1. I'm about done, I promise. I'm about to lose you. You're closing your Bibles and everything. Got enough revelation. I'm going out in the name of Jesus and have the devils out. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. Most of my life, before I really grew up and matured, I'm wearing my glass when I say something like that. Some handle it better than others. I mean, you know, I can look at some of you, and I realize, you know, we've got some sore losers in the congregation, but most people don't like to lose. You know why? Because we weren't created to lose. We were not created to be defeated. We were created to have dominion and walk in victory. Mankind was not created for defeat. We were not created to be beat up. We were created to walk in victory with dominion. And when man fell, he surrendered that. So everybody's like, well, yeah, I'm a sore loser. Now I got a good reason to be. I can see the smiles on your faces. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion. That's why we were created. Over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. We were created in the image of God to have dominion and authority. We were not created to be defeated. We were not created to be bullied. We were not created to be beat up. Psalm 8, the psalmist just marveled at how much authority was given to man. That he would be given authority over the works of God. That he would be given authority over the earth. Just marveled at that. But you see what happened? Man surrendered that authority. In the Garden of Eden, when man bowed his knee to Satan, the Bible teaches us that when we do that, we become the servants of that one we bow our knee to. And so we surrendered our authority. That's what Satan was talking about when he was tempting Jesus and he showed him all the kingdoms of the earth and says, this has been delivered to me and I will give it to you. He was offering that authority to Christ without the cross. But Jesus just cast it down. And then later on in the picture, the Antichrist is going to come along, and it says the enemy is going to give him great authority. But you see, Christ came and has restored authority to the human race who's born again to use the name of Jesus and to go forth in authority of God. But we've got to understand that. We've got to get revelation of who we are. We are not the enemy's victim.
Amen.
You are nobody's victim.
Amen.
Nobody's victim. God did not design you to be a victim. He designed you to walk in victory. You with me so far? So that's one of the key things that the Apostle Paul is praying for the church at Ephesus to get understanding of. And I think we cut it short sometimes. We think, well, praying for the church to get authority, to get revelation of Christ on the right hand of the Father. Well, absolutely. But we've got to understand why he's on the right hand of the Father. We've got to understand why he was ascended there, and what work he was doing there, and what he was restoring to us, and why it says we're sitting together with him in heavenly places. Authority has been restored. Authority has been restored. Exercise it and use it in the name of Jesus. Amen? Hallelujah. And power.